Hello, good afternoon everyone. Welcome to the Singapore GeoSpatial Festival 2021, an event that brings the international geospatial community together for co-located activities promoting the use of location-based and mapping innovation. This event is organized by GeoWorks, Singapore Land Authority GeoSpatial Industry Centre. To celebrate Singapore Land Authority 20th anniversary, we are excited to have Mr. Jerome Lim, a heritage enthusiast, a kid photographer and a blogger who captures Singapore's fast evolving urban and cultural landscape through the award-winning The Long and Winding Road blog. Jerome will be taking us through a virtual visit of the old Kallang Airport to discover the spaces within and learn about old Kallang Airport roles in Singapore aviation history. If you have any questions, please leave them in the Q&A chat box and we will answer them at the end of the webinar. Thank you, and without further ado, I will hand over to Jerome. Jerome, please.
Yep. Thank you, Nozu Leha. Okay, so what I'll do is I'm going to share a slideshow first. Good afternoon, everyone. So what I'm going to do is to just present to you about Kallang Aerodrome as Kallang Airport was first known, and its development and maybe, you know, its role in bringing aviation or its role in Singapore's aviation history. And I'll start off with the development, and then I will also later go into a very quick walkthrough of the main terminal building after the slideshow, and then we can go to the Q&A. Right, so I think one of the things that many of us may have heard about was, you know, Amelia Earhart. She was a female aviator or aviatrix who was the first to fly solo across the Atlantic. And she was really the one maybe who first put Kallang on the map. She arrived on the 20th of June 1937. And I think today we, you know, describe Kallang or sorry, Changi Airport as one of the world's best airports. So we already had one of the world's best airport way back then in 1937, as Miss Amelia Earhart has testified. So she arrived 20th of June 1937, touched down, flew off the next day. But you know, her arrival was just 8 days after the airport opened, so or the aerodrome opened. It was brand new. So this kind of traces her quest. So she was on a quest to be the first female pilot to circumnavigate the globe. And I think this been in the news too. We all know that her quest failed. She kind of disappeared from the radar, something like just less than 2 weeks after she left Singapore on the 21st of June, somewhere in the South Pacific. Never found, although there's been much speculation over where the wreckage is. But she left a lasting impression of Kallang Airport. So she called it, you know, so fortunately she had sent back, you know, diaries or diary entries through her flight at each stop off point. So she came to Singapore and she described it, you know, as an aviation miracle of the East. She called the airport, you know, the peer of any in the world. And she even, you know, described, you know, how she viewed you know, or what her impression was, her first impressions of Singapore were. So that's in that orange box there. But I think I'll just extract a little part of it out. So she says, you know, as a reminder that this was indeed the East. So she marveled at it, you know, being somewhere out in the East, you don't expect development to take place. She says, you know, when I shut off the engines from a nearby Chinese theater, music from a nearby Chinese theater floated up to greet us. And I think if you look at this aerial photograph of the aerodrome, you can see the terminal building, the two hangars next to it. And in very close proximity to that was the Happy World complex, part of which, you know, there was an actual theater, there were Chinese operas held. So it must be what she heard. It was very close by, and she would have parked at the hangar on the left side of the photograph. So I think it was quite remarkable, you know, she felt that it was quite remarkable. Right? But how did even, you know, Kallang come about? I think, you know, the first aircraft in Singapore we saw, 1911, that was something that was assembled in Singapore. This guy by the name of Joseph Christians, he assembled it, got the Royal Engineers to help him assemble it, took off for a demo flight from what's today Farrer Park, the former race course, and landed on the airfield. And then in 1919, it was our first inbound flight. It was this Vickers Vimy that was flying in from Darwin. It was an attempt to try to mark out a route over to London. So it took something like 22 days, you know, to fly from Singapore to London. So that was a kind of, a remarkable experience. So there were six aviators. It was a converted bomber. And the registration of the plane was GEAOU. So the joke that was going around amongst the crew was that what it stood for was God Help, or spelled with an apostrophe ELP, all of us. I think that kind of, you know, set the tone maybe. Our first civil flights actually landed at this place called RAF Sita. So RAF Sita development started at the end of the 20s. It was meant to be a military airport, but it being the only airfield, it took in civil airplanes as well. So among the first was flights to Batavia. So there was this Dutch airline, East Indies airline, that actually flew to Batavia or Jakarta today, Palembang, Batavia, and it landed at RAF Sita, or it did regular flights between Singapore and Batavia using RAF Sita as a base. That was in 1930. In 1933, there were our first, you know, flights, passenger flights to London, and that, you know, took something like, again, 20 days to fly. And guess how much it cost? It cost, you know, an arm and a leg. That was in 1933. Something to, you know, equivalent of maybe about close to 20,000 or even more, 24,000 Singapore dollars today. So flying certainly wasn't for everyone. So, I mean, the whole idea, I think flying was still in its infancy then. And the whole idea was, you know, we needed some kind of air terminal, and so thoughts, you know, started. The whole idea of Kallang Airport was mooted, right? And I think this is just to illustrate, you know, the effort it took to fly in those days. 20 stops sometimes, and, you know, over 20 days flight. Yeah. So where, you know, how was Kallang built? So Kallang was, you know, like most things in Singapore, built on reclaimed land. And what Kallang was, you know, was this whole swampy area. It was at the mouth of the three rivers, Rochor, Kallang, as well as Geylang River. And it was, you know, inhabited by tribes of Orang Laut or Sea Gypsies. Amongst them were the Orang Kallang and the Orang Bidwanda Kallang. They had to be resettled, moved to the north of Singapore, in places like what's today Punggol. But I think the whole idea was to try to reclaim the land there. The sea was very important. I'll come to why the sea was very important. And as described, you know, it was described as a pestilential swamp, fever-ridden, a plague spot of squelching mud covered only at high water. So can you imagine the scene, you know, it was kind of muddy, squelchy. I guess all the silt that's come out from the rivers over the years has kind of made it into this whole mess of a spot. But and it took something like 7 million cubic yards of soil, which came from Paya Lebar area, to fill the whole area. So work actually started sometime in 1932. Right, as we went along, so this is about halfway through, you see that the whole reclamation is taking shape, you have the kind of the intent of the reclamation marked out there, that circular kind of line that you see extending beyond that kind of semicircular projection. And a plane that flew over actually took this photograph of it, you know, halfway in completion. So it took a huge effort. By the time, you know, it was completed, it was something like 1936. And that's where the you know, the soil could be compacted. The terminal buildings were put up. So one of the things that you will notice on this chart that shows the plan for the airport, you will see the kind of a circular area, and you will see that it's also just by the water and with an opening outlet past Tanjong Rhu to the sea, and you'll see a sea lane, a lane mark there. So that was actually a lane for flying boats. So flying boats were a very important consideration. I will come to that. Which is why they decided to, you know, put the airport very close to the sea. And the other thing was, there was also this need for the terminal to be as close to the city or the municipality then as possible. You know, the whole effort of flying, and it took a huge effort, and you needed to be close because you. It was a stopover, may have been a stopover, and you didn't want to be too far away from your accommodation, overnight accommodation, for example. And, you know, having to put up overnight was probably one of the reasons why it really cost so much to fly. So you can still see that, you know, circular area even today. So this shows, you know, that kind of circular airfield. So why circular? It was. There was actually no landing strip. The whole idea was that planes could land from all directions. So we have to remember that planes then were light, small, didn't need a hard surface to land. So a landing field was sufficient. And in those days, the whole idea was to try to, or the state of the art, you know, was circular airfield with planes being able to land from all directions. But what you see in this photograph is actually just post-war. So what happened, you can see a little kind of strip, landing strip there. So that was actually metal and added by the Japanese during the war. So the Japanese used the airport, in fact, even before the Japanese occupation, the airport was used to land fighter aircraft. In RAF Kallang's case, before the war, it was a, you know, a dual airport. It was the Beaufort Boxers, which weren't very good when it came to fighting with the Japanese aircraft. But in any case, the Japanese laid a landing strip during the war. Then in 1951. The landing strip was extended. So what you see here is the extended landing strip that kind of extended beyond Mountbatten Road. The other thing you'll notice is, I think if you know where the area is today, this part, the first part of the landing strip that the Japanese laid, that's Stadium Boulevard today, and that extension in 1951 is Old Airport Road today. So there is, you know, still that memory of the airport in some sense. And the other thing is, the whole idea of, you know, extending the landing strip was really to land the heavier planes and to land the bigger planes and also the jetliners, which I'll come to. So if you look at the area today, you can still see, you know, that circular outline. You just open up a Google map or Google Earth, and you can see this. And you will see that on one side of Stadium Boulevard, you have the National Stadium or the new National Stadium. So the area was kind of repurposed over time. So besides the, so I'll come to the whole idea of the flying boats. So the flying boats were very important. So why the airport needed be close to the sea was for these flying boats. The flying boats were the ones that brought the mail in. They had wider bodies, as you can see here. They didn't fly too high. They flew slowly, but they could land at, you know, any part of the world where there was access to the sea. You did not need much infrastructure. You didn't have to build a whole airport just to land this plane, so it could be by the sea. And they carried the airmail, so there was lots of space within these flying boats. Very ungainly looking, but they were wide bodied, primarily because of the need to take off from water. You can see, you know, how luxuriously they could be also kind of arranged. So it was kind of the, you know, the luxury liners in the air of those days. Yeah, so I spoke about the whole idea of extending the landing strip. And it was ready to take this first jetliners, the Comets, that were to land in Singapore. So that really brought the jet age to Singapore. And I think it was quite an important step because, remember, you know, before the war, it took how many days? 22 days. It was cut down to something like 8 days to fly. And then after the war, I think you have this bigger, more efficient planes that could fly higher, less resistance. And they took even those propeller planes, they took something like 2 days to come to Singapore. So the Comets actually cut that down to 1 day or even less than 1 day. But I think unfortunately for Kallang, I think this really meant that its time was up because for one thing, the landing strip, even if it was extended, it wasn't sufficient. It was deemed insufficient. And the planes, when they really started, although the first Comet landed in 1951, when the Comet started regular service the following year, they actually used RAF Changi to land, bus the passengers over to Kallang, cleared immigration and customs and whatnot. And when they flew back, the return flight, they would again have to go to Kallang, check in there, be bused to Changi to board the planes. It was highly inconvenient. And I think by that time, the whole decision to move the airport to Paya Lebar was already made, and work actually started on it. Yeah, so I think one of the other things that happened just post-Comet, by this time, Paya Lebar was already being built. So this was in 1954. Just 1 year before Kallang closed as the airport, in March 1954. So we had this big crash which killed actually 33 people, involved a BOAC Constellation. It kind of landed short of the runway, hit the seawall, and burst into flames. I think this really highlighted the deficiencies of Kallang as an airport. And while, you know, in 1937, just maybe less than 20 years before that, it had been one of the world's best airport. By that time, you know, I think in 1937, aviation was still in its infancy. And I think, you know, with these bigger and heavier planes, I think the deficiencies of Kallang really showed up. And I think some of you may have heard also of this story of Dakota Crescent being named after Dakota crash at Kallang. That didn't happen at Kallang, actually. The plane did take off from Kallang. That Dakota plane that carried something like a number of, I think, policemen, it actually crashed somewhere over Cameron Highlands. So I think that story isn't quite true. So this was really the first and the biggest crash at Kallang, although I think it was actually the biggest and first crash at Kallang. So I think post Kallang airport, it closed sometime in August 1955. You can see that this whole repurposing of spaces, one of the things that you see here, so you see this view over Kallang Basin, you see the airport the air terminal right at the bottom of it. But what you see now is this highway that runs across between the terminal building as well as the former airfield. So, you know, we had things that were repurposed over time. That whole area where the landing field was, that became Kallang Park, and eventually what's today the Sports Hub. The National Stadium was built in 1973. There were other leisure facilities that were built. Incidentally, I think a bit of trivia, this Kallang Park, it was the venue for the Constitutional Exhibition in 1959-1960, when Singapore got its first self-government. As well as, you know, there were thoughts of actually building the National Theatre. So, you know, that whole idea of Fort Canning, where the National Theatre was, this was the original spot that was kind of mooted for that. The terminal buildings themselves, they were repurposed. In 1960, the terminal building became PA headquarters, People's Association. Some of these other things like the flying boat ramp and slipway that you see at the site, this later became Police Coast Guard headquarters. Those structures are still there. And you find that some other structures are still around. So what I'll do now is I'll just move on into a kind of a virtual walkthrough of the terminal building itself. So if you bear with me, I'll just switch screens and I'll stop sharing this and I'll try to fire up the video. Okay, I hope you can see this. So I think what you see are some of the buildings that are still existing. You have the West Block on the right of this screen. East Block, across from the West Block, you also see a concrete lamppost. There are in fact several concrete lampposts.
Sorry, Jerome. Yep. I think we can't see the screen.
Video.
Yeah, okay. Correct.
Okay, let me try again.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Okay,
can see. Okay, let me just restart this whole thing. Sorry about that. Yeah, okay. So let's start. So as I described, you know, once you enter what's now the main gate, it's actually part of the original compound of the airport, or the lead into the airport. You will see, you know, some of the existing buildings that are there, West Block, East Block, some concrete lampposts as well. These are all part of the conserved structures, including the terminal building that you see at the far end. So what this West Block and East Block were, they were originally attached to hangars. This is where the maintenance was. So, you know, in 1937, these hangars were amazing structures because they had quite a wide span, something like 150 feet, unheard of in a sense in Singapore at those days. And, you know, what these really were for were, you know, what really the West Block and East Block house were, you know, what you might think of as MRO kind of activities, companies involved in that in those early days. And I think the main focus for this walkthrough will be the terminal building. So we'll just walk by the terminal building, walk to the front. So I think right at the center of the terminal building facing the roadway, I would call this the back of the terminal. This is really where the main entrance to the terminal is. And I think one of the interesting features that you see is this symbol of the municipality of Singapore. And I'll just bring you to the front, which, you know, was the part that faced the airfield. Okay. Yeah, so I think the front is where, you know, the tarmac was. So in I think we think of flying today, we think of air bridges connecting the terminals. In those days, everything, you know, revolved around getting off the plane on the tarmac, walking into the terminal building. So once the plane landed airfield or the airstrip, it kind of, you see the airfield here, it will be taxied to the tarmac in front of the building. You can see the tarmac. And it's really to, everything is done manually in that sense. And so over the years, you can see how that tarmac has changed. So that tarmac has seen, you know, many important VIPs land, including Nehru, the first prime minister of India. So he was a regular visitor. And I think if you come to the front where the tarmac is, you can see the whole beauty, the aesthetics of the building. I think it was designed by the Public Works Department. And I think I just pause it here. By this guy, or credited to this architect by the name of Frank Dorrington Ward. So I think if you know the name, he's also associated with the old Supreme Court building. And you could see, you know, his kind of versatility in terms of design, because he could, you know, design this as well, which is very different from what you see, you know, on the old Supreme Court building. And I think if you look at the building itself, it's done in a streamlined modern style. So in streamlined modern design, very often what you see is, you know, this whole idea of mimicking everyday objects, including vehicles. And in this case, very appropriately for the airport, I'm not sure if you can see it, it actually resembles a biplane. So the two levels, the two projections, they kind of look like the two wings of a biplane. And I think the cockpit is really the control tower that you see right in the middle of the building. So just move on. Yeah, so you see a biplane here. So maybe you can see what I mean. Just take you very quickly inside as well. So if we go into one of the side entrances, there's a door we can go in. This is really what we think of today as the departure or arrival terminal, departure or arrival hall. It's very small, maybe 80 feet in length, you know, by today's standards. Of course, those days we didn't have duty-free, so really no need for much space. Double volume space, I think it's also very important for ventilation, no air conditioning in those days. And this was really how that space looked like. So we had telegraph offices, postal agencies, airline offices, information counter. And this is really from the inside of the terminal looking out to that main entrance that you saw earlier. So this, again, is the back of it, right? And you see that, get an appreciation of the double volume space. These grills were apparently, you know, the original grills. And if you go up to the second level, right, there's a kind of space that overlooks the hall. And around this, actually, there were restaurants or cafe, what we may think of as a cafe. So this is a young friend of a friend of mine who's very young in then. Right? His father actually worked at the airport, and he was a regular, you know, they regularly flew in and out. So this gentleman is now in Australia, Michael Meston, yeah, the young boy who's smiling there. Incidentally, he actually witnessed the crash of the aircraft, the BOAC Constellation. He was actually at the top of Singapore Swimming Club over at Tanjung Rhu, which had a kind of view across to the airport, and he actually saw a plane crash and burst into flames from the top of it. Yeah, so I think if you go to the front of the building, there's this very interesting spiral staircase. So this is contained within that kind of a cylindrical area that you see, right? And if you go up, this is actually what leads up to the control tower. So there's some quite interesting plasterwork. I think that's quite reminiscent of the plasterwork that's found on St. Andrew's School building in Woodsville. And this is kind of half level. What you see is a deck up. We can go up to the next level. Right. So this is the deck proper. We'll come to that. And this is on the third level. There's a very narrow spiral or iron spiral staircase that leads you right up to the top. So that will be the top level there. So we were at level 3, going up to level 4. And if you go up that spiral staircase, it leads you to this little space. It's where all the control activities took place, the control tower. Again, very small by today's standards. So the space allocated was really for the instrumentation, the navigation aids that were available in those days, not very sophisticated. A lot of things was done by sight. The airport, in fact, didn't have night landings because of the primitive equipment. Anyway, night landings weren't possible until much later. This was really how it looked like. But I think up at that level, there's also a kind of balcony. So I love one of the parts of the airport that I love the most because it gives you this all-round view of what's around. There's some additional structures that were added in the 1950s that you saw there. Again, you see the hangar here attached to the west block. You will have noticed maybe the hangar is missing, so that was demolished from the east block. Nickel Highway and across to the stadium. So the stadium is really where the start of the landing field was. Yeah, so we're back inside. Nothing so much to see anymore. Just a very nice glass-windowed space. The staircase again. So you can really see that there wasn't really much space available. Incidentally, those kind of aluminium structures that you saw, kind of greenish ones, they were actually where CMPB Kallang was located. So we're back down on the third level. There's a very nice open deck. You can see the expanse of the deck. Some of these spaces like this, they will actually serve a dual purpose. They also serve a entertainment purpose. And by night, the airport was closed. There were dance parties that were actually held on the up there on the deck. And of course, there is why this deck was there was also it gave access to the front. There's a kind of a waving deck or where you kind of wave goodbye to your friends who are departing, who are flying off, or saying hello to the people who are there. Right. So again, I think if we look, sorry, I just go back there. Yeah. So if you look to this side of the airport, right, that was really where Happy World was. So Happy World became Gay World, also famous for wrestling matches. It was an amusement complex. And it was really the space that Miss Ye Hart was talking about when she, landed and heard the Chinese theater from. Yeah, so that's a view of the west block again. So there's the staircase down that leads you down to this lower level. And just to give a sense of that space where, area where dance parties were held. Nickel Highway. So we are at the kind of lower level which would have overlooked the tarmac. So this is where you stood and waved hello or goodbye. And instead of the tarmac and the whole landing field that you see across. What you see now is Nickel Highway and the stadium. Right, and which kind of brings us to the end of this virtual walkthrough. Just have a short look around this, what we can call the viewing deck. So there's lots of space. So what we know is that this building is conserved. So it's gazetted for conservation along with the west and east block, along with some of the concrete lampposts. The main entrance gate, which we didn't see, that's over at Kallang Road. And so again, that space in front was the tarmac. Of course, we now know this whole space was is cut through. We heard about the importance of the sea, the flying boats. Yeah, and this actually shows some flying boats. In 1953, this was a formation done during the Queen's coronation. Those planes actually took off from RAF Seletar. Right. And then there was this whole conversion into repurposing of the space, building of Merdeka Bridge and Nickel Highway in 1955, opened in 1956. And what's left, I think for most of us, what we see, you know, traveling on Nickel Highway is this building. Yeah. So I've come to the end of the walkthrough as well as the presentation. So I can take questions now.
Okay, I think we have three questions. Yeah. So okay, let me show the first one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So where might one be able to find more of these old maps?
These old maps are available in a few places, including the National Archives, the National Library, National Archives. Some you can actually find online, and there's some that you need to make a request to view, but they are available. I hope that answers the question about the maps.
Okay. The other one is also from Nathaniel Tan. Let me show. Okay. Regarding the flying boats, did they land near to Kallang Airport or was it just a general mention?
When you say a general mention, I'm not sure what you actually mean. But they did land. They did land at Kallang Airport, and as I mentioned, I think about the repurposing of some of the facilities. So they did land, they were serviced there, they were hauled up for repair and inspection, and those reception facilities are still there. That's the former Police Coast Guard headquarters, so there is a boat slipway, there's also a boat ramp that was ready to haul up and, you know, to bring down the planes back to the sea. Yeah, so I think there was also a photograph. Maybe I can try sharing that again. Sorry.
Okay, yeah, let me close. Okay.
Yeah, so I actually flashed a photograph of a flying boat of Kallang. Let me try to find it. That actually shows a Pan Am clipper. So I'm not sure how many of you remember this American airline called Pan Am or Pan America. So they actually also started a service, I think it was in 1941, to Singapore. But you can see this is actually off Kallang. You can, in fact, see the spire of St. Andrew's Cathedral somewhere, very faintly in the background. As well as Raffles Institution, which was also very close to the sea. So, would you be able to see my cursor? No.
No.
Okay, maybe not. No. But if you look at the wing of the wing on the port side, or what's on the right of us, very close to the wing, you see the kind of shadowy projection. That's actually the spire of St. Andrew's Cathedral. And on the right of that, you see some whitish building that I can identify as the former Raffles Institution at Bras Basah Road. So you can see that, you know, it was something real, it's something that took place. Yeah. Okay. I hope that answers the question, Nathaniel.
Okay, we have another question. Mm-hmm. Okay, from Basanti. Where were the air traffic controllers seated?
Seated as in where were they? Where was the working space, I guess? That's what you mean? Yeah, okay. So Basanti, I think it's right at the top level. You know, remember, during the walkthrough, there was this kind of a iron staircase, spiral staircase, kind of similar to what you see at Chimes. But that kind of led up to the top. So that's the fourth level of that cylindrical projection that you see in the middle of the terminal building. So they were all stationed up there. Yeah, so I hope that answers the question.
Okay, there's some more. I think this is just
observation.
Observation, okay. Correct.
But thank you for it. Yeah.
Okay, another one more. Under the chat from Louis Lu, because he put in the chat, so I can't show it, but I can.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay.
So he asked, can we recommend to URA to turn the old Kallang Airport to an air museum, incorporating both the history of air travel in Singapore and history of Singapore Airlines Group?
I think URA is always open for ideas. I think there will be some attempt to try to repurpose the terminal buildings. I think there was an announcement made in 2019 or 2020 about this program called RSVP, or it's a joint project by URA and SLA or Singapore Land Authority. I think which RSVP, it means rejuvenating spaces. We're very fond of acronyms. Let me try to get this right. Rejuvenating spaces into vibrant places. I hope I got that right. Yeah, so I think Kallang Airport will be one of the places that where some ideas are being sought to try to maybe turn it into repurpose it in the interim, because we all know that this will be part of that greater Kallang Riverside rejuvenation. But you know, in the interim, I think before that happens, there'll be an attempt to try to find meaningful use for the space. But I think that probably that air museum is be something that is it's something for the longer term. So I mean, these ideas can always be submitted. Yeah. I hope that answers the question.
Okay. Do we have any more questions? Wait, someone left a question on the main feed. Oh, okay. Okay, there's another one question. I tried to see if I can put on stage. Okay, yeah, this one.
Yeah.
It's actually from Alan Chung.
Yep.
Chung. He said Jalan Benan Kapal is located on the same side of the Kallang Aerodrome. Were there shipbuilding activities at the site of the Kallang Aerodrome area at the same time as when the Kallang Airport was operating?
There are two parts to this. I think there were, some kind of native or whatever you can call it, boat building activities that took place more in areas like the Rochor River, places like Tanjung Rhu. Tanjung Rhu, in fact, had a few big shipyards and probably where the first big shipyards in Singapore were located, including a naval shipbuilder by the name of Prosper Thornycroft. In fact, you know, that whole activities lasted until the 80s when they went bankrupt. Singapore Slipway, or what's today Sing Marine, or part of Sing Marine, also was there. United Engineers, that was at Tanjung Rhu. But this whole idea of Jalan Benan Kapal, which actually means shipbuilding road, It really was only established after the airport closed. So that was really on the, maybe on the Kallang River side of Kallang Airport, the landing field. So that was given to shipbuilding activity sometime in the 60s. So among the, you know, the shipbuilders that were there was people like Eagle Engineering overseas. They're small family-owned businesses. So what we see today are maybe some of the remnants of the industrial buildings along Jalan Benaan Kapal. So there were actually two parts to it. I think, you know, we saw post Kallang Airport, the whole redevelopment of the space. So besides shipbuilding, there are also other activities, including, I think some of us, people of my age, you know, age of dinosaur, we'll probably remember the Wonderland where we got our, you know, thrills, our G-Force thrills with the roller coaster, which wasn't very impressive. I mean, if you think about what we see at USS today, but it was not nevertheless, you know, a place where we got our fun at. I think later, you know, there were many other developments, including the National Stadium, Kallang Theatre, Indoor Stadium, and of course today the big sports hub. So that's all, you know, repurposed part of Kallang Airport. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Nathaniel, for sharing the question. Okay, I think the other one will be from Vanessa. She asked, okay, what ideas does the audience have to reinvent the old Kallang Airport?
I think that's a question for the audience.
Oh, audience. Oh, sorry.
But I mean, they are, as I said, I think they are attempts to seek ideas. And of course, I think, you know, from the URAN, they probably welcome any ideas that you have. So I think there will be engagement sessions in future, I guess, on this. And, you know, if you have any ideas, you know, you can always write in to the various authorities, including the URA, to share your ideas with them.
Okay, there's some more question. Okay, let me show some more. All right. Okay, did the biplane service cease immediately with the relocation of the airport?
Biplane, I think
seaplane. I think he means seaplane. Yeah. Seaplane services.
Biplane is outdated, the kind of you see in the First World War kind of movies, right? They were also used as stunt planes, but seaplane services actually ceased before the closure of Kallang Airport. We had seaplanes that were used for military use right up to the 60s, but seaplane services in Kallang actually ceased, let me see, sometime in 1940. See, I got it here. Yeah, 1949. So they became kind of inefficient, slow. And I think, you know, the new planes that were coming up, I think a lot of the wartime developments actually contributed to the, you know, bigger planes being developed, faster, quicker planes. So I think that kind of you know, made the seaplanes or what we call flying boats redundant. So I think there's also a distinction. When you say flying boat, it's something that with the boat hull that takes off, those tend to be the bigger planes. The seaplanes are smaller. They were actually planes that landed on floats. Right? So they were smaller planes. So it was more the flying boats that this Kallang was taking in. Yeah. I hope that answers the question.
Okay, I think the audiences, they are giving suggestion to whether to keep keep
the terminal?
The terminal, to reinvent it or not.
The terminal is, I mean, the terminal building, the west block, east block, and the hangar that's attached to the west block are all conserved structures. So you can find them in the URA website. You know, they have a conservation portal, and you can find the whole the set of buildings that are conserved identified in them. And I think, you know, you can always write into URA should you have any ideas. I think they're always looking for ideas, and it'd be interesting to see what's going to happen. I think we don't want it to become another mall, most of us.
Yeah. Right? I think for me, I would prefer to be an air museum.
Yeah.
at least we know the history of it.
Yeah, actually, why not, right? But I think, I guess it's a question of, do we have the RSAF, for example, Republic of Singapore Air Force, they do have their own museum over at Paya Lebar Airport.
Mm.
Yeah. But that's, the military side of things. And maybe the time is right for a civil aviation museum. And I guess Kallang Airport would make a wonderful space for it. We remember the first civil airport at the same time, as well as, remember its role in aviation history.
That's true. Okay, there's some more question from me, Leong. All right. Did the Paya Lebar and Kallang Airport coexist in both operation at some point? I think there's a continuation to the question. Yeah.
Okay.
I noticed that Mountbatten Road, formerly known as a Grove Road, cut across the airport runway. Was this always the case?
Okay, the first question, did it coexist? It didn't quite coexist. So on the 21st of August 1955, the whole operation was transferred over to Paya Lebar International Airport. But there was a last plane that was stuck at Kallang. That was actually a plane that belonged to the flying club. It was badly damaged and it was in the hangar in Kallang under repair. So the airport had to be, it actually closed, but that was something like 2 months later in October 1955, that plane left the airport. But to say that, it coexisted, I don't think it coexisted and was fully operational. So there was this transfer. But there was this last plane that only left in October because it was under repair. And I hope that answers the first part of the question. So the second part is...
The second part is from another person, from Alan Leong. Yeah. Okay. So, about the Mountbatten Road.
Okay. So Grove Road actually, it didn't originally cut across the runway. So the runway, remember, was extended in 1951. Right, so it did cut across then, and according to people who lived during that period, they would have remembered that there were actually some kind of like gantries or gates that closed up, every time a plane had to land. So it was like a railway crossing, so to speak, or airplane crossing. So it was highly inconvenient to road users then. So I think the same thing happened at Changi in the old days, Changi Road actually extended up to what's the airbase today, and there was a kind of a runway that cut across the old Upper Changi Road. So that was also the case with Changi Road. So there were people to man these things to close them so that traffic can't pass while the plane landed. Yeah. So this was post-war. Runway extension. I hope that answers the question. Any more questions?
Oops, sorry, I was on mute. So sorry. Wasn't there a floating restaurant also in the Kallang Basin attached to the Kallang Airfield?
Not so much a floating restaurant. I think that was later on after airport closed. There was these three pods that kind of projected out into the Kallang, what we call Kallang Basin today. So these were actually, run by Oasis Restaurant. So this was in the 70s, post-Kallang Airport development. Of course, we know Oasis today operates a restaurant at Toa Payoh, very famous for their Teochew porridge. But I think it was a kind of a, it was more than a restaurant. There was, entertainment hub too, that was in that area. So it was all that part of that you know, repurposing of the airfield, repurposing of the spaces around the airfield, and this whole idea to transform it into a kind of a leisure and a recreational destination. So I hope that answers the question.
Okay, the next one is a follow-up question from Nathaniel. Yeah. So yeah, the transition from Kallang to Paya Lebar was pretty much overnight rather than done in trenches.
I think it was, I mean, okay, we talk about volume of air traffic then. I don't think it's, you know, as heavy as it is now. So it could be pretty much done overnight. So remember, Kallang, no night landings. I think in terms of flights, not many a day. So there was this whole plan move already made. So they made sure Paya Lebar was up and running. So there was a kind of also ceremony of the last plane taking off and the first plane landing in Paya Lebar. Of course, there would have been some transfer of aircraft, you know, in the meantime that happened over the course of a week, few days maybe. But I think I mean, if you think about that whole transition, it was pretty much overnight. So I hope that answers the question.
Okay. There's the next one from Wilson. How was the transfer between Paya Lebar and Kallang done?
Okay, so I think I answered that question in a sense already. So I think the whole idea was to, you know, move operations. So there was this whole idea of the last plane landing and the first plane taking off, or the last plane taking off and the first plane landing. Of course, you know, in that whole process, there would have been some transfer of aircraft, as I mentioned. But as I answered to, I think it was Nathaniel's question, it was pretty much done overnight.
Okay, I think it's one of the last few questions. Yep. Okay, was the old airport road the main road to the airport?
Yeah, so old airport road was that extension of the runway of the airport made in 1951. So the whole idea was to prepare the runway, extend it to take in the bigger and heavier planes that were being developed post-war. And so the first section of the runway, the part up to Grove Road or Mountbatten Road, that is now Stadium Boulevard. Of course, it's only part of the runway that you see today because of the whole development of the sports hub. But by and large, Stadium Boulevard is the first part of the runway. That extension of the runway over Mountbatten Road, that is what is called Old Airport Road today. So the main entrance to the airport, you will see that off Geylang Road. So it's near Geylang Lorong 1 area, just across from it. If you head in the direction of the airport, you see some gates. That was the main entrance. Of course, those gates are no longer connected to the road, but they're still there. And that really was the main entrance to the airport, or the main road to the airport. I hope that answers the question.
Okay. Let me see. Okay, this one, I think it's a follow-up question, I think, from Wilson.
Yep.
Yeah, he asked if, is it fair to say that some point in time we have both free plane and biplanes at the Kallang Airport?
In a sense, the first, I won't call them seaplanes, they're flying boats. Seaplanes tended to be smaller. So the flying boats are the ones with boat hulls that take off from water. Seaplanes too, but seaplanes land and take off on floats, and they tended to be smaller. So it was the flying boats. And some of the flying boats, the early flying boats, were in fact biplanes. So biplanes meaning you have two levels of wings. I think most of the earlier planes that used Kallang, I think by the time Kallang was used, there were very few biplanes, but certainly there were seaplanes that were, you know, configured as a biplane. And yes, that did land at Kallang Airport or in the sea, the so-called harbor or flying boat harbor that you would have seen at Kallang Airport. So I hope that answers the question.
Okay, I think that's the last question. Okay. And I think we have already...
Okay, hit the 1 o'clock.
Yeah, hit 1 o'clock. Okay. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much, Jerome, and to the audience for all the questions that you guys have sent. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much for coming to this webinar. We also have another webinar happening. The next one will be at 1:30. It will be on Thomson Map of Singapore. So if you're interested, you can go and check it out. Okay, thank you so much, and we hope to see you later.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.